Good evening, everyone. My name is Mark Weistuck. I'm the interim executive director of the Skirball program, and I would like to welcome you this evening. We are pleased and privileged to present Dr. AVIVAH GOTTLIEB ZORNBERG, who will offer a lecture entitled Sing Now to God, exploring the relationship of a very famous biblical brother and sister, Miriam and Moses. Dr. ZORNBERG lives in Jerusalem, where she has been lecturing on Bible since 1980. What distinguishes Dr. Zornberg's analyses is her reading of the Bible, of biblical narratives, through the prism of Midrash, literature, philosophy, and particularly psychoanalysis, allowing each of her sources to illuminate with fresh insight and understanding the questions inherent in the text. The experience of listening to Dr. ZORNBERG thread through her sources and extract new interpretations is exhilarating and downright thrilling. At the end of tonight's lecture, if you have heard Dr. ZORNBERG before, you will reconfirm for yourself why you avail yourself of every opportunity to learn with her. And if you have not heard her before, you will know that you will never miss an opportunity to study with her in the future. Her name as a lecturer and writer has spread far and wide. She has been invited to speak in South Africa, Australia, Hong Kong, and Singapore. On this side of the Atlantic, she regularly speaks at synagogues, JCCs, psychoanalytic societies, as well as Hillel houses of prominent universities. And I'm pleased to say that she is an annual visiting scholar at our Skirball Center, a tradition which we hope that will continue in years to come. Dr. ZORNBERG holds a visiting lectureship at the London School of Jewish Studies. She has been awarded an honorary doctorate by JTS and the Eisendrath Bearer of Light Award by the URJ. AVIVAH GOTTLIEB ZORNBERG is the author of three critically acclaimed books: Genesis, The Beginning of Desire, for which she won the National Jewish Book Award; The Particulars of Rapture, Reflections on Exodus; and The Murmuring Deep, Reflections on the Biblical Unconscious. All three books appear in paperback, and all three books, plus DVDs of her lectures, will be available for purchase in the lobby after the lecture, when you will have an opportunity to have Dr. Gottlieb autograph your purchase and answer questions about the lecture. AVIVAH ZORNBERG was born in London and grew up in Glasgow, Scotland, where her father was a rabbi and the head of the rabbinical court. She studied Torah with him from childhood. She also studied at the Gateshead Seminary and the Jerusalem Michlala. Her PhD in English literature is from Cambridge University, England. She taught English literature at the Hebrew University for 7 years before turning to teaching Torah. In 1997, after the publication of her first book, she appeared on the PBS television series Genesis, A Living Conversation with Bill Moyers. Please join me in welcoming Dr. AVIVAH GOTTLIEB ZORNBERG.
Thank you very much. Good evening. Rather dimly, I can see people through the dazzle, and I'm very happy to recognize so many people that I'm very fond of. Well, we have a difficult subject. I can't say I've worked out this enigma at all. The enigma of a sister and a brother who are both prophets. The enigma of a sister who at a certain moment in her narrative, begins to attack her brother. She begins to speak against her brother. Vatidaber Miriam. V'aharon b'Moshe. This is towards the beginning of the book of Numbers, which in Hebrew is the book of the Midbar, the book of the wilderness. And there is this classic pun that goes back to the ancient days of the Midrash that plays on the word Midbar, Midaber, Dibur. That what happens in this wilderness where the people wander ultimately for 40 years is that people speak all the time. In fact, they do nothing but speak. There's really, all the rebellions are rebellions of language. They're all rebellions of doubt and suspicion and verbal attack of one kind or another. Miriam's case stands on its own. It's a special case. For one thing, she is singled out in a way that no one else is singled out in the whole story of Israel in the wilderness. There is the story of Korach, where he is clearly the hero of that rebellion, but he is surrounded by a whole constellation of supporters. In this case, it's a private attack. As we'll see, it's an extremely private attack, more private than one might think. A private critique of Moses. And what exactly that critique is not so clear. So what I want to do is to start with this puzzling story and to try to highlight some of the really incomprehensible things about the story as it stands in the Bible and then the story as it appears in Midrashic sources. There's a huge gap between the biblical text and the Midrashic narratives. And then to try to look back into Miriam's life and to try to understand what is behind her talking against Moses, B'Moshe. So that's our agenda for the evening. And I want to start right away by looking at the narrative itself. From the first verse onward, this is chapter 12, and some of you have been preparing. Others will, I hope, follow on now from the way I read it and the sources you have on your page. So, chapter 12. Vatidaber Miriam v'Aharon b'Moshe. Miriam and Aaron spoke against Moses about the Haisha Kushit asher lakach, about the Ethiopian woman that he had taken in marriage. That is, it seems that they are attacking Moses, their sibling, for marrying an Ethiopian woman. Now, we haven't heard before this of any Ethiopian woman that Moses married. The only woman he married was called Sipporah. And so we are faced right away with an enigma. What is this? Who is this Ethiopian woman who seems to be the subject of Miriam's attack? That's why Miriam is critical of Moses. And not only is she mentioned here unprecedentedly, but there's a repetition immediately afterwards, for he did take an Ethiopian woman. Right? In case you didn't get the point the first time, that he really did marry an Ethiopian woman. Now, what do we do with this basic situation? Let's continue meantime. They said, what was it they said? Clearly, it's two people speaking here, but Miriam is clearly, equally clearly, the leader. How do we know that she's the leader? Because of the way the language is used here. Vatidaber Miriam. If you had heard them when they were attacking, you might not have known who was the leader. You might have thought, well, it's a concerted attack by the two siblings against the third sibling. But because we get the story not by watching a film version of it, but we get it through words, through the biblical words, we can hear that vatidaber, the singular feminine, that actually the real, the thrust of the attack came from Miriam. Aaron is just a kind of collaborator. He is not at the front of this. It really is Miriam. And we are let into that secret because of the language. The language tells us that that's the case. Otherwise, we might never have known it. And then we hear about this Ethiopian woman, and again the Ethiopian woman, and then we hear what they said. Harak ach b'Moshe diber Hashem. Did God speak only through Moses? Did he not also speak through us? And so you hear what they actually said. What they said was, clearly, that they feel in some way troubled by the fact that Moses seems to be priding himself on his singularity as a prophet, whereas they feel they have some kind of parity with Moses. They are both prophets as well. And so there seems to be some kind of work of envy here, that they are looking at Moses and they're thinking, you know, who does he think he is? Although we don't know why they would say this. Who does he think he is? We are just as good as he is. We also have prophetic experience. Vayishma Hashem, and God heard. That's the end of the verse. And it's tacked on there as if to say, that's what they said, but God heard. That is, that God is listening hard to what they're saying, and he hears what they're not saying. He hears something beyond what they're actually saying. It's God who's listening in here, and he's going to react now. Instead of Moses reacting, God will react. So what is the situation here? What is the connection between what they say, which is an expression of some kind of envy, prophetic envy, if you want to call it that, prophet envy, against Moses? What's the connection between that and the fact that Moses had married an Ethiopian woman? There seems to be no connection at all. It's two separate issues. If they're upset that he married a foreign woman, let's say a black woman, then that's one thing. But that has nothing to do with the prophet envy idea. So how do the two things knit together? What are we talking about here? And particularly, what really interests me, and that what's the very thin thread that is going to somehow carry us across the abyss of this evening, is the little prefix, b, that they spoke against Moses, b, Moshe. And it's very clear that b means against. On the other hand, right away you have again the use of the prefix b with a very different meaning. Did God speak only b, Moshe? Did he speak only through Moses? But he also spoke through us. So the prefix bet, b, can mean either against, they spoke against him, or it can mean to speak through someone. And the two meanings, which are very different, are right next to each other. You really can't miss it. So those commentaries that notice it say, well, of course, it means quite a different thing. You can't mix up these two uses of the prefix in, against, and inside, through. But I want to mix them up. That is, I want to suggest that the prefix here is the key to the whole story. That there is something about the way Miriam talks against Moses, which has to do also with her talking in some way in a kind of deep embeddedness with Moses. That is, she's speaking her against Moses, her adversary statement has to do with how very embedded she is, how very, what's the word I want, not entangled exactly, how very invested she is in Moses. That she has a relationship with Moses that means that she imagines Moses. That she imagines Moses from the inside out. That she doesn't come as some stranger who attacks him. She attacks him as a sibling. She attacks him as a sibling who has a unique relationship with him. There is no comparison between this sibling relationship of sister and brother and any other in the Bible. It's a unique relationship, and that's what I want to trace. The attack is related to the closeness of the relationship. So who is this Ethiopian woman? The interesting thing is, if you look at the commentaries, you start looking around at all the commentaries, they divide up into two groups. One group are what's called the Pshat commentaries, Rashbam, Ibn Kaspi, many others, Ibn Ezra. And basically what they try to do is to make something of this strange, never unheard of fact that he married a black woman. For instance, someone, I think Rashbam, says, well, if you look at a certain Chronicles of Moses, some book he's consulted, maybe a Midrashic collection, then you'll find that Moses actually spent 40 years in this land of the Ethiopians, where he married the queen. And so he was effectively the ruler of Ethiopia at that time. And this is what Miriam is talking about here. Now, the interesting thing is that this is the Pshat commentaries. who want to say this kind of thing. These are the ones who are very upset with Midrash. They are very upset at how the Midrash torments the basic, the clear meaning of the text in order to say something very different. So they desperately want to find some kind of historical meaning, some kind of mythic meaning to the actual words. That Ethiopian woman, so maybe he really did marry, and I found some evidence for it in some, you know, some godforsaken library, you know. And so I'm scholarly, and so I can come and say that this is the meaning. And why does the Midrash do what it does? Now, what does the Midrash do? And here you have to fasten your seatbelts, and we'll look at Rashi together. Rashi gives us the gist of these Midrashic commentaries. And I have to say, before we start looking at it, that when I say you have to fasten your seatbelts, it's because the words of the text are taken to mean almost the opposite of what they say. You have a way of inverting the meaning of the words of the text so they mean the opposite of their plain meaning. Have a look. Number one on your page. Miriam and Aaron spoke against Moses. She was the one who opened up speech. Patra Trila. She began this speech act, this exercise in speech. That's why her name is put first. How did Miriam know? Now here it begins the commentary in an oblique way. How did Miriam know that Moses had actually separated himself from his wife? And that's what's implied in the text. The text says he had married a Cushite woman. What that means is, in this Midrashic reading, not that he had married, but he had actually separated from his wife, the only wife that we know he has, which is Zipporah. In fact, that he had taken on a kind of vow of abstinence, that he had become sexually abstinent. Now, how did Miriam know this? That should have been private. That should have been a private issue. How did he know this? And so Rabbi Natan says that it was a woman's matter. She was by the side of Zipporah, Moses' wife, at the moment that Moses was told that Eldad and Medad, two people in the camp, had started prophesying in the camp. Two people had suddenly been possessed by some kind of prophetic spirit and had gone out and started prophesying within the camp. When Zipporah heard this news, she said, and she said it in the company of Miriam, privately, "Woe to the wives of those men. Woe to the wives of Eldad and Medad, because they now will no longer have relations with their husbands. If they've become prophets, that's the end of that. That's the end of their sexual lives." And Miriam is listening, and she picks up from that is Zipporah's fate. That Zipporah is here mourning herself, and she is saying, "I know now what will happen, because that's what has happened to me. Moses, the great prophet, has separated from me." And this is a fact that no one, by the nature of it, no one else should know about. It's a completely private fact of Moses' life. But it comes out in this women's enclave. Women, Zipporah can't hold back when she hears about these two people who have suddenly become volunteer prophets. Suddenly it seems there's an outbreak, a kind of prophecy is spreading like wildfire in the camp. And the old sense of there only being one prophet is being broken, and poor wives in that case. And that's how Miriam knows, and she tells it to Aaron. And she doesn't mean, here Rashi adds, she doesn't really mean to castigate him. She doesn't really mean to critique him. She's just commenting. She's just saying something about the fact that he has now abstained from prophecy. Nevertheless, she's punished. How much more so are those who do really criticize others, who speak slander against others, how much more so are they punished? So somehow Rashi wants to say this really wasn't a very antagonistic attack by Miriam. She was just, in a way, commenting. What about this Ethiopian woman? And here, again, you need to tie your seat belts, and let's listen to what's said about that. Ethiopian means that everyone admitted her beauty. Everyone recognized her beauty, just as everyone recognizes the blackness of an Ethiopian. That is, to call her black is simply to say there is something absolutely indubitable about her. Just as at first glance, You can tell when a black person is black, so you could tell when you looked at Zipporah how beautiful she was. So it's emphasizing actually the opposite of what the text seems to be saying. The text is talking about Moses marrying a black woman, and it's decoded now to mean he separated, having married his wife, he separated from a woman who was as beautiful, as obviously beautiful, as a black person is obviously black. And the whole point then is about the undoubted beauty of Zipporah, of the wife. Moreover, another way of talking about her beauty, Cushit, the word Cushit, Ethiopian, if you look at its numerological, you do a calculation, add up the numbers, it comes to the same word as the word for beautiful. So it's another way of saying this is really a code, Cushit is a code, and it translates as beautiful. And then again, Miriam spoke against Moses because of that woman, because of the fact that he had effectively separated from her. The way it's put is that he had divorced her. Now, he hadn't officially divorced her, but in their intimate lives, they were no longer together. And that's what Miriam is critiquing. Miriam is commenting on the fact that Moses has separated from his wife, and that's the connection with what Miriam and Aaron say next. We, too, have received prophecy from God, and we had no need to abstain from marital relations, to separate from our husbands and wives. Who does Moses think he is that he has taken this step of abstaining from marital relations just because God spoke through him? And so there is the sense that there's a certain kind of envy now that Miriam and Aaron feel, which is based actually on a sense of a kind of competitiveness. Who does he think he is that he thinks that a spiritual life precludes a sexual life? That's to put it very simply. In our experience, it's simply not so. That's not the way it is with us. It never was so with us. And based on our experience, we can't help thinking that Moses is somehow arrogating to himself superior powers, that he wants in some way to set himself apart in some excess of asceticism, that he's pushing himself away, pushing women away from himself. And there is something troubling about this. There's something that Miriam particularly can't stand about this inability to live a sexual as well as a spiritual, let's say, or prophetic or inspired life. And that is her not antagonistic critique, according to Rashi. What happens after that is more comments about her beauty. You shouldn't have any suspicion that it was anything actually, there was nothing personal about this separation. It wasn't that Moses separated from Zipporah because he didn't find her beautiful. Her beauty was absolutely patent. It was spiritual and physical. Now, she would be the person most capable, actually, of sustaining the intimate life with Moses that you can imagine. And yet Moses rejected her. Moses rejected sexuality, and Miriam is extremely disturbed by this. The last comment in this very difficult passage is that the reference to the Ethiopian woman is by way of avoiding an ayin hara. Like someone says about her beautiful child, he's really very ugly. So as to avoid the evil eye, not to attract. Zipporah is really very beautiful, and here she's called black, which in biblical times was not a synonym for beauty. Shchora ani v'na'ava, in the Song of Songs. I am black but beautiful. That clearly is the meaning there. And so she's called black in a way to cover up, to screen the fact that she was really so beautiful. Again, that theme again and again. In the next line, we have a simple translation of the complaint of Miriam and Aaron. Did God speak with him alone? Indeed, did he not speak also Banu, through us? And we didn't separate from our mates. We didn't separate from our sexual lives. In other words, it turns out that the attack on Moses has to do with something that Miriam feels particularly strongly. She is the leader in this attack. Aaron may feel it in a kind of general sense, but Miriam has a very personal reason for feeling that there's something very wrong with this situation. And that's what I want to begin to follow up, the relation between sexuality and prophecy. Moses is the only case we know of, read through the Midrash, where a prophet felt that he had to separate from his wife, simply on the basis of his prophecy. Why is it that Miriam finds this so impossible to stand? Well, we go back to the beginning of Miriam's story. You remember how she began her life. She began her life standing by the river, Moses' sister, standing by the river, watching from a distance as her son, as her brother, her baby brother, Moses, is floating in a box in the river. And then we go back into the Midrashic background of this. Miriam will later be called a prophetess. Miriam Hanaviah, when she comes to the Red Sea, at a later moment, after the Exodus, she will be called Miriam Hanaviah, Miriam the prophetess, Achot Aharon, the sister of Aaron. That's very striking, because she is, of course, the sister of Moses. You would have thought that would be the major prestige. But no, sister of Aaron. And the Midrash comments on this and says, well, at the time she became a prophetess, at the time she was privileged to have God speak through her, she had that experience of God speaking in her, from the inside of her. At that time, she was only the sister of Aaron. She had one big brother. But Moses had not yet been born. And she becomes a prophetess at the moment that she makes it possible for Moses to be born. Do you remember that Midrashic tradition? Her father has separated from his wife. Notice the theme. Her father has separated sexually from his wife because of the Egyptian persecution, because of the decree against male babies that they are to be thrown in the river. Why have male babies? Why have babies altogether? The father says, and he is, in the Midrash, he is the head of the rabbinical court. He's the Av Beit Din, Av Sanhedrin of that time. He is a judicial figure. And he decides for himself and for all other husbands in the people that it's better not to have marital relations than to have children who will be killed. And that's one of these difficult decisions that sometimes leaders have to take, that it's better to have no babies at all than to have babies, half approximately of whom, will be murdered. But Miriam does not accept this. And she comes and she protests to her father. She protests to her father and she says to him, Hofia panim keneged aviha. Very strong expression in the Midrash. She shines her face against her father. She's identified with Puah, one of the midwives. Puah, Hofia, she comes and she radiates. She sends the laser beams of her face against her father, against great strength of personality. And she says to him, your decree is harder than Pharaoh's. Right? It's a very famous Midrash. Pharaoh decreed only against boy babies. You are decreeing against all babies. You are actually more thoroughgoing anti-life force than Pharaoh himself. And her father listens to her, and he reunites with his wife. And the whole people then reunite, the couples reunite. So there's a kind of mass movement here of separation and reunion. And the reunion is effected by the rhetoric of Miriam, by the way Miriam uses language. Gzeratcha kasha mishel paro. Your decree is harsher than Pharaoh's. So I've always wondered, what is it that Miriam has really told her father that has been so effective? Surely her father knew when he made that decision, that hard decision. He knew what the effect of it would be, that no babies would be born, right? He knows the facts of life. He knows if you don't have relations, there'll be no babies. So what is it that she has actually done here with him? And I'd have to say that what she has done is to put him in the same setting, as it were, as Pharaoh. That is, it's her way of using a figure of speech here. Gzeratcha kasha mishel paro. That way of framing the reality. Look at you and Pharaoh together. Do you like the comparison? That somewhere has the effect of making her father emotionally aware, as he might not have been before, of what it means to put an end to all possibility of a future. And so he reunites with his wife. But then, if you have a look at the Midrash in number 2, you can see how the story continues. The time comes when they can no longer hide the baby, and the baby is, they prepare this cushioned box and close it and put it in the river, where male babies were supposed to be thrown in any case. And his sister stations herself at a distance to find out, to know what would be the end of this story. Why did Miriam stand at a distance? At a distance. So the sages say, Rav Amram, in the name of Rav, says, because Miriam was, at that moment, she had just prophesied. And she had said, my mother is destined to have a son who will save the people of Israel. And when Moses was born, the whole house was full of light. Her father then rose up and kissed her on her head. Her father expressed approval and love. The house is full of light. You see your prophecy was correct, that really this is going to be the savior of Israel. So she is in her father's good graces. He says to her, my daughter, your prophecy has been fulfilled. And that's why it later says, at the Red Sea, that Miriam, the prophetess, the sister of Aaron, took those timbrels and began to dance with the women. At that moment, she was not the sister of Moses, but now she is the sister of Moses. Moses is now endangered, and when the baby has to be put into the river, then her mother stands up, in this version of the Midrash, and taps her on the head. It probably means something like, gives her a little, slap, a little slap. Hard to say, but yes, a slap. Her mother slaps her on the head and says to her, my daughter, where is your prophecy now? In other words, her prophecy has gone into eclipse. She is not at this moment considered a Neviah. She's not called a prophet because no one thinks of her as a prophet at this moment. They think of her as a failed prophet. They think of her as someone, all right, momentarily, she came through. Her prophecy came through, but now you see what is taking over. Pharaoh is the one who is winning now. All right, the baby is now in the river, and her mother hits her on the head. In other versions of the Midrash, it's her father, and I think that's really more effective. Her father both kisses her when things are going well, and then slaps her when catastrophe seems to be in the offing, and then says to her, my daughter, where is your prophecy now? And that's why it's written now that she stood there at a distance to know what would happen with her prophecy. At a distance. And this Midrash implies, and other Midrashim make it clearer, that at a distance means that she is alienated from her family. That the cost of her prophecy has been that her family have now, in a sense, disowned her. Because she's got them into this trouble now. That they've had the baby, and now the baby is exposed on the river, exposed to destruction. And here she is, alone, waiting to know what will be with her prophecy. She is bearing the brunt of a lone prophecy, in which what she did was reunite a husband and wife, husbands and wives throughout the people, who were separated, which she found unbearable. She found that separation somehow intolerable. She brought them together, and the result is that, in a sense, she loses her family. That her family, in a way, don't want to have anything to do with her. There she is at Merachok. She's somewhere at a distance, alone with her inspiration, alone with her knowledge that God did speak to her in some sense, that it wasn't, she didn't volunteer this by herself. And there she is, waiting staunchly, I would say, vatetatzav. She stations herself. It's a peculiar use of the verb, like hitzyatsev, but not quite. She stations herself staunchly. She is full of a sense of determination and of waiting it out. She is waiting it out now to see how the story will turn itself around. Now that is chapter one of Miriam's prophecy, in which the idea of celibacy, of marital celibacy, is what her prophecy told her to critique. That she attacked her father, as it were, through her rhetoric, in order to reunite the couple and the couples then who are the people. The Redeemer is born as a result, and her father kisses and reproves her. Exodus, the Red Sea. There is then a song of the Red Sea. Az Yashir Moshe, Uvene Israel. Moses and the children of Israel, Moses is the leader, he will sing a song. And you notice it's the same formation of Moshe Uvene Israel with a singular verb, as later we'll find with Miriam, Miriam and Aaron with a singular verb, Batidaber Miriam. But here it's Az Yashir Moshe Uvene Israel, that Moses is really the one who gets the song flowing. He is the one, and it's put in the future tense. He will sing, he would sing. Why is it in the future tense? And so Rashi says on this, Yashir, Allah belibo she yashir shira. Inspiration arose in him. That is, there's a sense, an idea came up in him. It occurred to him, Allah belibo. It occurred to him that he would sing a song. As if this is a somewhat counterintuitive inspiration. As if the reality situation isn't one that you wouldn't necessarily think would inspire a song. Well, it depends how you read the timing of the song. And here we have a fascinating difference in readings. Many people think, many of the commentaries and readers think, that the song is sung after they are home and dry. After they've crossed the Red Sea, they're on the dry land, and then they sing a song of celebration at the fact that they survived and the Egyptians are finally defeated. But there is another school of thought, which I find very, very poignant, very meaningful, which says, no, they sang in the midst of the sea, b'toch hayam b'yabasha. And there are ways of showing that that's so. The Sforno says so, the Ramban says so. There are some of the great medieval commentaries actually make that claim. So the song was to be sung when they were in the midst of the sea, betoch hayam, on that precarious dry land with the walls of water looming over them, mi minam u mismolam, on the right hand and the left hand. Not exactly home and dry, actually, anything but. There they are in the middle of these immense waves, which are being kept artificially erect on either side of them. And they're walking on these corridors, and at that moment of great danger, I would say, of great terror, when they are aware of the Egyptians with the waves crashing down upon the Egyptians just behind them. At that moment, it occurred to Moses that the thing to do would be to sing a song. As if it's a really counterintuitive idea. Why did he think that that was the thing to do? To sing a song. And then everyone starts singing absolutely in unison. So there is a Hasidic passage in one of the great Hasidic masters, the Shem Yishmuel, 19th century Hasidic commentary on the Torah. And he asks a rather strange question. He says, how come everyone sings in unison, as it sounds like, Moshe Uvene Israel, that everyone seemed to come up with the same words and the same melody all at once? Surely, there can't be any such thing when it comes to prophecy. And here the whole people, in a sense, become prophets. God is singing through them. And we find an idea that no two prophets prophesy with exactly the same words. If it's a true prophecy, then it has to have something original and unique about it. Each prophet has his own, puts his own uniqueness into it. But here, everyone is singing together. And what the Shem Yishmuel wants to say then is, that everyone sings together, even babes in the womb, right? That's a Midrashic, even they joined in this Shira. They don't even have organs. They don't have organs of song, organs of speech, says the Shem Bishmuel very literalistically. Yes, but so how can they sing? And the point he wants to make then is that actually they are not singing, that it sings, that this, a song is sung through them. And the only thing, right, each one has their own disabilities and their own personal experience and their own lack of organs because they're just embryos. And there is Moses, and everyone all together sings because a song begins in some way. It sings. There's an inspiration here that hits everyone in the same way. Everyone shares in this. And in this sense, Moses is not different from the rest of the people. And something begins to emerge from them, which is called a song. What is the only personal thing about this song? What is personal here in this possessed people who suddenly begin to sing? What is personal is Allah belibo sheyashir shira. That original inspiration, I want to sing a song. A song should be sung now. That is the personal thing. That's what makes it Moses' song. That's what makes it the song of Bnei Israel. But otherwise, there is something about this song that has to do with possession, with something general. And it arises from the first line, Zekeli v'anvehu. What sings through the people? This is my God, and I will beautify him. So there's a certain kind of apprehension of God, a prophetic apprehension of God. They actually see God in some way. And here I want to bring into play the long and rather wonderful Midrash in number 3. You can see on your page. I'm not going to look at the whole thing. I'm going to paraphrase part of it and then look at the end. The women particularly, among the people we're talking about now, what leads them to sing a separate song? They are actually the first to recognize God, claims this Midrash. Because in Egypt, they had had babies in great peril, in great danger. They had gone out to the fields alone, without midwives, to go through these secret births, to have their babies. And God had come in his glory, or someone had come from the upper worlds and acted as midwife to them. So that these women have been taken through their moment of greatest danger, the moment of giving birth to a child, attended by a midwife who is actually someone from the upper worlds in one version, or actually God himself in another. Therefore, they know God in a very internal, profound, and personal way. For the women, this is not an impersonal matter. It's a very personal matter. They know God because God was the one who brought them through that particular strait, the straits of birth in Egypt. So that when they see God over the Red Sea, they recognize him first, says the Midrash. Heim hakiruhu tchila. They have a very personal recognition of God. Oh, there he is. Zeh keli. And there is that sense of immediacy. I know that God. And therefore, the Midrash claims, even though the text says it's Moses who initiates the song, actually, it's the women. It's the women who have had this Egyptian birth experience. And they're the ones now who take a leading role in this more personal song. What do Miriam and her women, they come provided, we read in the text, with tupim uvim cholot. They come provided with timbrels and with circle dances. They come dancing in a ring and they come provided with timbrels. And Rashi comments, he asks, how come they had timbrels with them? They didn't have time to pack bread, to prepare bread for their journey. But, oh no, they remembered to bring timbrels. And Rashi puts it very sweetly. He says, Muftachot hayu tzidkaniyot shebador. These righteous women of that generation were assured that God does miracles for them. And so they brought these timbrels with them out of Egypt, because surely they would have use for them. They expect miracles That is, these women, somewhere in the course of the continuity of their lives, which includes giving birth in great danger, if giving birth isn't always dangerous in that time, they are used to the fact that God does miracles. Somewhere they're attuned to that. That's not an exceptional event for them. And so they bring timbrels because you never know. In other words, we'll surely find some use. There'll surely be miracles along the way. And so there's a certain calmness and serenity about Miriam and her women. They are somewhere to the manner born, to the manner of miracles, and to the manner of singing and dancing. And so they have a particular approach to this issue of singing and dancing. And taking this further, Miriam and her women, they sing and dance in this way in the midst of the sea, betoch hayam. And this reminds me of a provocative idea that is proposed by the philosopher Stanley Cavell in a book called Opera or the Undoing of Women. He asks a question about operatic heroines. He notices that operatic heroines have a rather high mortality rate. Heroines, he says, she who sings must die. A rather lugubrious statement. She who sings, operatic heroines sing and therefore are doomed to die. What does it mean when a heroine sings, when a woman sings? The voice of song, he says, the voice of song is, in opera particularly, at any rate, opera is naturally pitched at a brink between two worlds. This world, right, the normal world in which one is seen, the roughly familiar world of philosophers, says Cavell, and another realm from which to be heard, one to which one releases one's spirit and which recedes when the breath of the song ends. Operatic heroines in general are singing their longing, their desire for some other world. Call it the world of love, call it the world of rapture, for some other realm which is just half a step away from this one. That is, you don't really need to travel long distances to get to that other realm. It's the otherness, right? The sense of something beyond, the transcendence, is actually always right beside where you are now, in a sense. Cavell has a beautiful sentence when he says, "Our beyond is not eventual, but always." Olam haba, right? The world to come, is not eventual, that at the end of days we'll get to it. That's the way we normally think of the world to come. But it is always. It's to come at every moment. At every moment there's the possibility of that song that aspires towards something other, something else. And the women know about this movement from childbed to an apprehension of God, from deep danger to an apprehension of God and a song of some kind. But for opera, thinking in terms of opera, Cavell says, opera gives us woman expressing her desire. And that is always dangerous. How will she ever come back from that world of desire to the real world? How will she bridge the gap between what she yearns for, what she desires, and the life that she must live among people in society, among men who both want and don't want to know what it is she really desires. That is, they want and don't want to hear her song. That argument, that thesis of Stanley Cavell, gives us a sense of the breath of the singer, the breath of the operatic heroine, expressing longing, separation, the breath that lets in the world and lets out the world, the pain of the world and the hope of the world. Whatever causes happiness does not occur in absence of pain. Singing, he says, expresses the experience of being pressed and stretched between worlds. And women's singing exposes them to death, the use of the voice, to the stopping of the voice. It exposes the power of desire, which is simply a woman thinking. When a woman sings in opera, that's a formal way of expressing the fact that she is thinking. She is thinking out loud. She's thinking in such a way that no one is ignorant of what it is she's thinking, of the desire that she is encompassing. She is expressing the inexpressible, and she is departing from all settled habitation at this moment. Miriam and her women. Miriam and her women take these timbrels. They're set for wonder. Miriam, who is Miriam? Why is she named Miriam? Another Midrash says, because she was born in the time of Vayimararu et Chayehem, in the time of when the Egyptians were embittering the lives of the Israelites. That is, Miriam carries within her name, she is the singer, she is the dancer, and she carries within her name the melancholy and the oppression of that time. She was born at that time, and therefore she sings. She sings for a place of transcendence, for a place of otherness. Vayimararu et Chayehem. There is a very famous and resonant midrash that I'd like to look at with you then, number 5. Who then is Miriam and her women? What do they stand for at this moment in the sea when she's called the prophetess? Number 5. In the future, God will be at the center of a dancing circle of the righteous in the world to come, la'atid level. And there's a quotation from Psalms 48. Set your hearts on a dancing circle, cholaktiv. And these dancers will dance around God, ba'olamot, ba'alamut, they're playing with the words, and they will point their finger into the center, and they will say, for this is God, our God, forever and ever. He will lead us, ba'almut. He will lead us dancing like young girls. Strange metaphor. At the end of days, what you will have is these, you know, all the good people, dancing in a circle around God like young girls. And this is a kind of reference, it's a code reference, to Miriam, who is called Ha'alma, the young girl, when she rushes to save the baby, to bring the baby back to her mother for nursing, you remember. There she's called the young girl. And therefore, the reference to Miriam and her young women and the women who come after her gives us a kind of point of reference for the way in which ultimately, in the ultimate light of God's presence, in that ultimate glow, how the righteous will dance. They'll dance like young girls, bizrizut, with energy and with buoyancy, like young girls. Like those young girls, betoch alamot tofafot, like those young girls with drums. Other meanings of that word, almut, work in a very different way. For instance, almut, beyond death. God will lead us in that ultimate dance of the righteous, beyond death, almut. So here you have eros and thanatos. On the one hand, the young girls dancing with joy and buoyancy. On the other hand, the dancing beyond the realm of death, transcending death. And on the third hand, third translation, olamot, right? Plays on the word. Olamot, between two worlds, between this world and some transcendent world. And so we have the sense that these women come to represent that movement of being pressed and stretched between worlds. That they're not fully at home in this world, that they want an opening out to some other world, and that they know that it exists, and there they are, and they don't die of it, right? These women, unlike operatic heroines, they are taking the risk of song, they're taking the risk of expressing an unearthly desire, which is domesticated in the midst of their lives. It's right there in the midst of their lives. They don't have to go somewhere to the heights of Tibet to find it, right? There they are in the midst of the dangers of the sea, and from that place they sing. And their song, therefore, allows them to enter into an extraordinary passage, a Hasidic lyrical passage, which is in number 6 on your page, and which I'll paraphrase. This is the Maor Vashemesh, 19th century Hasidic master, commentary on the Torah, in which he says this: the women dancing in a circle. Women dancing in a circle is a mythic, iconic expression of the feminine, the circle rather than the straight line. This world is run on linear principles. This normal, the normal social world that we live in, is run on hierarchic principles. One is higher and the other is lower. There is a teacher and there is a student and there's a king and there's a servant. This world is run on masculine principles. This principle of the straight line, hierarchies. The alternative is the circular principle, and that is the circle of the feminine. At the end of days, there will be a circle of the dancing righteous. That is, the feminine principle will prevail, but actually it will come to suggest a transcendence of either male or female. It will mean there's no more male, no more female, that we are actually in a transcendent realm in which all the hierarchies and differences of this world have disappeared, all the distances and differences of this world have disappeared, and there's simply a wheeling circle with everyone equidistant from the center. Now that ultimate hope, that ultimate image of things, is described by Jeremiah, Nekeva tesovev gever, that in that time, the female, in that new covenant, the female will go round and around the male, as the bride does under the chuppah, right? The circling around. To sovev really means, in some sense, that she will have the courtship role. To sovev is that she will be the one who will court him. She will be the active one. She will be the active principal. And she will, that will be her role. That's how reality will be. What happens in this dancing circle in the midst of the sea, says the Maor Vashemesh, is that the women's vision of reality in this moment prevails over the men's vision of reality. Because Moses says at the beginning of his song, Ashira Lashem, Kiga Oga, I will sing to God, for he is very mighty. That is, at some point in the future, there will be that ultimate reality, that transcendent reality, in which there will be that song and that dance around God. But the women change that first word to Shiru Lashem. Sing now to God, hence my title. Shiru, in other words, the women, Miriam and her women with their dances and their circle dances and their timbrels, what they are doing is something unprecedented. They are not waiting for transcendence. They are actually, the expression is himshichu, that they draw down, it's a Kabbalistic, the mystical expression, they draw down that ultimacy, that sense of transcendence, right into the heart of reality, as it is here in the world. And they bring that down here. This is hakafot, says, this is hakafos, yes? This is what we do on Simchat Torah. This is what we do on Hoshana Rabbah. That mystically speaking, what we're doing is bringing down, it's a feminine movement of bringing down an ultimate state and domesticating it within reality as it is now. In doing this, the women have apprehended, have made real a state of things, says the Maor Vashemesh, than which there can be nothing beyond. In other words, an ultimate state of things. They have made, they have domesticated, they have housed within their own reality. And that is a superior state to Moses' state. Miriam knows that at this moment she is inspired, just as she was inspired at that original moment when she spoke to her father and risked ostracism by her family and by society. But now here she is surrounded by the whole people, bringing into play, bringing into reality a kind of ultimate state. Now that description, that ecstatic description of Miriam, gives us the sense that when she reappears in our story, the story we began with, when she reappears, She comes and she speaks, B Moshe. She speaks against Moses, and she speaks with intimate knowledge of what it is, like Moses, to have God speaking through her. That she knows that that song and that dance and the whole inspiration had God speaking through her, Banu, just as Moses did. The Eldad and Medad, the two prophets who Zipporah pities their wives, you remember. Eldad and Medad, when they start prophesying in the camp, a lad comes, a na'ar comes to Moses and is very exercised and says to Moses, Adoni Moshe Klaim, they are trespassing on your prophetic rights. These counter-prophets, these alternative prophets, are trespassing on they're trespassing on your supreme rights in this case. And Moses answers them at that point, answers this lad, and says, don't be so jealous for me. I wish that all the people of God were prophets. So for Moses, it's a perfectly open, it's open opportunity. Anyone can and perhaps should be a prophet. But whoever it is, this lad, perhaps it was Joshua, perhaps it was Moses' own son, in some way he's faulted for his intervention here, that he tries to make Moses, in a sense, jealous. But here is Miriam now, and Miriam comes, and she says, I know that I have had a unique prophetic experience. There is no one who can convince me differently. I know that God has spoken through me on both occasions. That is, when she brought her parents together, on the one hand, and then in the sea, when her song and dance enacted something, made something real, made language mean more than just language. And God, what does God do to Miriam when she protests at the singularity of Moses? In what way, then, is he special? What we hear immediately after that in our story is that the man Moses was very humble, more humble than anyone else in the world, so he can't speak for himself. What happens then is that God suddenly speaks to Moses and Aaron and Miriam. He speaks to all three siblings, and he speaks to them suddenly, unexpectedly. And he says, all of you, all three of you, shloshtechem, the most unusual biblical word. All three of you, all of you are prophets. Now leave the camp and go out to the tent of assembly. And all three of them did leave. Vayetzu shloshtem. And God then came down in a pillar of cloud, and he stood at the entrance to the tabernacle, to the tent of assembly, and he summoned Aaron and Miriam, and they too came out. So you notice it's a kind of strange cluster of prophets at first, who leave the camp, all three of them, all three siblings. And there they are in the tent of assembly. And then God comes to the entrance there, and he says, now two of you come out, Miriam and Aaron. And Moses is left inside the tabernacle. So gradually there's a kind of whittling down here. And these two now leave that place of prophecy. And God then actually gives them a prophecy. God speaks to them, and God says to them, listen to my words. Even if you're a prophet, even if you have prophecy from God, he is different. Lo chen avdi Moshe. He is not like you other prophets who speak through visions and through dreams. In all my house, he is faithful. B'chol beti ne'emanhu, the strange expression. In all my household, he is the faithful one. And God speaks rather mysterious language here. Mouth to mouth, I will speak in him. I speak again in him, bo, through him. And not with visions, but not with riddles. And he sees the image of God. Why have you not feared to speak against my servant Moses? And God is angry in them, against them, and he leaves. What I want to suggest is that Miriam's anger and jealousy, let's say envy, of Moses, has to do with a very intimate awareness always of Moses. Moses is the man who actually, her the brother, who came into being because of her prophecy. And her sense, her very deep sense of her own inspiration, of her own capacity, her own prophetic capacity, is something that she then tries to see as continuous with Moses, as something that is the same thing as Moses. She can't conceive of it in any other way. She is, in a sense, the space between herself and Moses ceases to exist. It ceases to exist out of, not originally perhaps out of envy, but out of a profound sense of identity. That just as God speaks through him, so he speaks through me. And for the life of her, she can't imagine, having had the experiences she's had, she can't imagine what you might call the singularity of Moses. She can't imagine any sense in which Moses is really different from her. Now, for us, there may be feminist issues involved in this kind of story, as there often is in dealing with sisters and brothers, in the ambitious sister who, in a way, nurtures her younger brother. She brings him into the world, in this case, the very extreme form of nurturing. Right? She brings him into the world and then lives to see him grow past her, lives to see him grow greater than her. At least that is the story that she has to believe. And to begin to question then some basic modes of the differences between the two of them. Here is Moses now separated from his wife, whereas her deepest instincts are that sexuality and prophecy can coexist, that prophecy is betoch, is in the midst of things, it's in the midst of life, and that life doesn't have to be set aside in the prophetic experience. But here is Moses, who is, in a way, closer to herself than she is herself, if I can say that. That Moses is, he is the very core of her being. That is how, originally how she knows prophecy, through the prophecy about Moses. And therefore her attack on Moses, against Moses, Moshe, comes out of a sense of deep interiority and deep intimacy with Moses himself, Moshe. If her own experience is valid, she would like it to be validated by Moses. That is, that there should be a continuity. She should be able to look at Moses and recognize herself in some way. But here is Moses being different. Here is Moses, as it were, arrogating some kind of special status and separating from women, in general, separating from his wife. And here is God now saying to Miriam, all you other prophets are different from Moses. Moses is singular. You may have dreams, you may have visions, but he is different. He is Ne'eman. As if to say in some way, and this is a very interesting comment by the Sfatimet, I put it on your page in number 9, Lo ken avdi Moshe. Moses, my servant, is not so. Is not the way you, his prophecy is not the same as your prophecy. It's a different quality of prophecy. You can't imagine, you can't extrapolate from yourself to Moses. Now that is the most difficult thing that Miriam has to accept, because she wants to extrapolate. She wants to feel that it's all of a piece, that prophecy is all of a piece, my prophecy, his prophecy. And she wants to feel that a person is all of a piece, that sexuality and spirituality are part of the same weave, part of the same tissue, and that one doesn't have to cut oneself off from one state in order to achieve another state. And here is Moses clearly invested in a very different way of living his life. According to the Midrash, the way he knows that he has to separate from his wife is because the people as a whole who experienced prophecy at Mount Sinai are told by God through Moses, now you can return to your tents. After the revelation, they're told you can return to your tents. And that means they can return to their sexual lives. They had separated, men and women had separated for the revelation on Mount Sinai. And once the revelation was over and their prophecy was over, their tenure as prophets had come to an end, they could return to their sexual lives. From that, Moses understands, and God then says to Moses, but you stay here with me. They can return to their tents, but you, amod imadi, stand with me. You can almost hear the play on words. You stay with me, which is understood to mean you have to separate from your wife. Now, that's something that Moses decodes from what God says. He doesn't know for sure that that's what God wants. He comes to a certain conclusion. If the people can return because the revelation is over, then I can't return to sexuality because I am available at all times. At all times, I'm available for prophecy, for revelation. That's the difference. And therefore, I can't be preoccupied with this other state, which we call sexuality. And he comes to this conclusion more or less himself. Here God corroborates him and says, pe el pe, I speak to him mouth to mouth, which in a strange sense mimics the sexual reality. It's a way of saying you can only have one partner. Yes, that I have an ongoing relation to Moses, which means whenever he wants and whenever I want, then this prophetic pairing takes place, this coupling takes place, and so he can't be preoccupied otherwise. But when Moses comes to this conclusion, he's not totally sure. God hasn't actually told him so in so many words. Now, in this situation, the Sfatimet says, Moses is ne'eman. There's something about Moses, we're saying that all other prophets are not faithful, that surely can't be the case. Miriam and Aaron are prophets. But like all other prophets, they have occasional visitations of prophecy. That God comes and suddenly he's there. And there is a suddenness about this. Suddenly he's there. And they are inspired. Moses, on the other hand, and so their prophecy has something of the dream or the vision, something where you can't totally be sure that you're wide awake when this is happening. You're in an altered state of some kind. Moses is not in an altered state when he receives revelation. He is ne'eman. Ne'eman means unchanging. Moses is in a way, that's the barely human aspect of Moses. That there is something steady about him. There is something even about him. Whereas all other human beings, when they receive a revelation from God, they are deeply stirred. They are panav panapnehem bo'arot kelapidim. It's a wonderful expression that's used in the Midrash. Their faces flame like torches. That is, blood rushes to their faces and they're full of heat and light and suddenly transformed and transfigured. All the excitement of an altered state. Whereas Moses is amazingly even, because he's always in that state. He's ne'eman, v'chol beti ne'emanhu, which means that in a sense there's no excitement, that Moses doesn't get excited in these experiences, because he always has to be ready for kind of ongoing revelation. Perhaps, as Sfatimet suggests, that's why he has to wear a veil. Because when he's speaking to people, there's a kind of ongoing light in his face, which in a way is overwhelming for other people. So he is in a different category. What category are Miriam and Aaron in? They are in the category of prophets and visionaries who receive occasional prophecies and who experience the ups and downs of such revelations. And here I want to take a sidetrack and open up the issue in a way that I hope will be helpful. And this is what I want to suggest. I go back to the beginning of the world, the Garden of Eden. The Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve, they were naked and unashamed. They were naked and unashamed. That's a description of the way in which Adam and Eve were not like human beings that we know. They were in an exceptional state. And there is a fascinating commentary by the Hermekdavar, the Netziv of Elohim, in which he suggests this. Lo yitbashashu, it's an unusual word for they were not ashamed, should really be lo yevoshu. busha. Lo yitboshashu, he suggests, means lo boshesh, is they were not delayed. They didn't suffer time gaps, time lapses. Whenever they wanted to come together, either with God or with their mate, with each other, either sexually or in terms of mystical revelation, they were immediately in the right state. They're immediately naked, as it were. They're immediately there for that condition. What they didn't have was what we all have experienced since the fall, as we call it, which is the situation of a delayed reaction, as it were. That you want dvekut, you want intimacy, whether it's sexual intimacy on the one hand or intimacy with God, prophetic intimacy. And there's a process of arousal that has to happen before one can achieve it. That it isn't instantaneous, that we don't leap right away into the fulfillment of our desire. Some kind of process of what's called hit-ororut, of arousal, has to happen. It's a description, really, of feminine sexuality, the need for that process. That's what creates shame. That's what creates a certain kind of self-consciousness, that one doesn't immediately leap like a flame into union with the other, but that rather there is a whole process by which one has to address one's humanity and try to move between this world and another world. Now, that rather slow and sometimes impeded movement, inhibitions of various kinds, memories of various kinds that come to arouse one, or the opposite. Yeah. Yeah, the complicated life of desire, if you want to put it that way, I'd like to put it that way. In that sense, that is where shame comes. Shame, a certain kind of self-consciousness. Miriam wants to feel that there is no need for any kind of shame, that there is no conflict between one moment of intimacy and another moment of intimacy, intimacy with a human being and intimacy with God, as if we're all of a piece. We are all, really, it's a kind of simplification of life that Miriam would like to impose on life, because she's had a very strong experience of something like that, of an oceanic reality, of a reality in which there is no jarring between one reality and another. The fact is, though, and the Midrash actually says, this pitom, the sudden appearance of God, what's the suddenness of it? And Rashi quotes this Midrash, it's a very rather strange Midrash, is that she is actually in the middle of marital relations when God suddenly calls her. And so she's put right on the spot of recognizing at that very moment that things are not necessarily as continuous as she would like them to be. That actually the time is out of joint, that we do know such an experience of the time out of joint. I'm deeply involved in one state, and therefore I need time, I need some kind of process to move into the other state. Now, in terms of a normal human life, what happens to Miriam is that she cries out, mayim, mayim, water, water. That she wants in some way to go through some kind of ablution, some kind of mikveh, to move from the one state to the other. As if, after all, perhaps things are not as continuous, not as cut all of a piece as she would have liked to feel. And in that sense, she begins to understand why Moses, who constantly is at God's call, he's a specialized means by which God communicates with the people, why he has to abstain from his personal sexuality. But the point, I think, mostly is that what Miriam experiences as a result of being put on the spot in this way, what she experiences is something of that shame that she had wanted to deny is relevant at all in these realms of sexuality and spirituality. In a certain sense, ultimately, Miriam is right. That ultimately, there will be the dancing circle of the righteous around God, and that feminine confidence that in the midst of things, there can be the very intimate experience of God. Ultimately, that expresses a truth. And yet, What Miriam is not prepared to recognize is something that God wants her nevertheless to recognize. And that is something about Olam Hazeh, not Olam Haba, about the gaps that exist between this world and that other world of desire and aspiration, about the gaps and the distances and the differences. That actually, in a sense, one can live in profound affinity with one's big brother, Moshe, with a profound sense that he and I are really the same, that we are continuous with each other. And what I know in my most intimate reality, surely he must know the same thing. And at the same time, God then comes and says to Miriam, and I put on your page an extraordinary passage from the Me'a Shiloach, which I will try to paraphrase. It's in number 10 on your page. I will try to paraphrase it. In which what is enacted in God's answer to Miriam is something like this. Partially, when Miriam looks at Moses and hears the words of God, she experiences something that is identical to Moses' experience. That is, she's so deeply embedded with him, she's so deeply involved with him, that she has an intimate sense of Moses' prophecy. At certain moments she has that, and at other moments, suddenly, it's blocked from her. That's the way the Hasidic writer puts it. It's blocked from her. It's blocked from her means that she suddenly realizes that she is not Moses. There are moments when she empathizes entirely with Moses, where she feels that she is Moses, and there are times when she realizes the absolute difference and distance between them, that they are not the same person. And she can move forwards and backwards and forwards between these two states. And that describes a kind of uncanny nature of a certain kind of relationship, sometimes between siblings, actually, of being so deeply empathetic, of knowing what it's like to be the other person from the inside, to be identical with the other person, and then to experience again, no, the gap, the distance, that is a separate person from me. And somewhere the relation between Miriam and Moses, as perhaps the relation between a brother and a sister, quite often, has something of this doubleness. Of, on the one hand, being absolute twins, absolute, we are the same, and this is my most intimate ground for knowing sameness. This is how I know about sameness, because I do have this sibling, in this case, gender separate. And at other moments, the absolute difference between the two becomes obvious, and I know that there are things that he can experience that I can't experience, and there are things that I experience that he can't experience, and this is the home ground of a certain difficult and necessary education in the paradoxes of sameness and difference, of the paradoxes which give rise to envy, which give rise to a very real envy, that I am the same as him. Ah, but I'm not. Now, somewhere that paradox gives rise to the experience of shame. And what God says at the end when Miriam suddenly is struck leprous, you remember, suddenly there she is, and she's struck leprous. And Moses prays for her. Kel na rafa na la. The shortest prayer in the book. The shortest prayer there ever was. Please, God, please heal her. And she is healed. And then God says, but if her father would spit in her face, terrible expression, if her father would spit in her face, would she not at least be in an experience of shame? At least for 7 days. She would feel that experience of being shamed by her father. Now, in that statement, what's encapsulated in that statement? All of Miriam's past. The fact that her father really did shame her, that her personal father did shame her by hitting her on the head and saying, my daughter, where is your prophecy? And that she stood it, that she managed to stand that shame, to stand solidly at a distance from her family, recognizing that they are not her and she is not them at this moment, and standing united with Moses, watching over Moses and waiting to see how the drama would play out. Now, that shame, what happens to it now? After all, who is shamed when the father shames the daughter? You might say that it's the father who should be ashamed, right, in a certain sense. Right? What did she do to deserve this? She actually was acting out her conscious sense of a revelation of God, her sense of prophecy. In this case, God says, but if the father shames a daughter, and that very delicate relationship, a father and a daughter, in spite of everything, there is something that the daughter knows that's called shame then, whether it should be so or should not be so, whether she should simply say, I'm interjecting a shame that really belongs to the father. The fact is that there is an experience of shame. And I want to associate that shame, the shame of Miriam now, put outside the camp. She's placed outside the camp, like impure people, like lepers, for instance. She's placed outside the camp. Aaron takes one look at her, and he sees, behold, she is Metsura'at. Behold, she is leprous. Now, there's a kind of doubleness here. We're told separately that she is leprous, and suddenly Aaron looks at her, and behold, she is leprous. And the Hemek Davar says something that's quite resonant here. He says, Metsura'at means she is closed up in herself. Metsura'at, sgiru in Aramaic, is the Aramaic translation for Metsura. What is it to be leprous? As we translate it now, it's not really leprosy. It's to be closed off from the world, to be closed off from the world. And he looks at her, and what he sees is not just a physical condition, that she has some kind of skin ailment, but he sees that she is dumbfounded and in great grief at what is happening at this moment, that she is dumbfounded, ne'elemet, that she is, Metsura'at now is the psychic consequence of the experience that she's being put through now. That somewhere there she is closed up in herself. She's closed up in herself and silenced, that there is nothing that she can say at this moment. Here she was the leader in this language exercise, this way that's attacking in and through Moses. And now suddenly she's silenced. And what I understand by that word silenced, I looked it up and tried to follow some of its associations. The idea of being closed up, sugiru, misugeret, what it is to be locked up in that way. And I find that it's an image not just for the physical condition of leprosy, but which does have a hesger period. It has a quarantine period in which the patient is unclear, and the priest, the doctor, the diagnostician is unclear about whether it is or is not leprosy. So it's a kind of limbo period, a period of hesger, where she's left in a way to see how things develop. I find other uses of that idea of being locked up, misugeret, to suggest a situation of being baffled, bewildered, of being totally engrossed, I like that word, totally engrossed in one's own situation so that one doesn't know what to think. That seems to be the meaning of the term, misugeret, of that kind, in the Talmud in a number of places. Miriam is in that sort of psychic place now, where everything that she's always thought, which goes back to the beginning of her life, really, back to the beginning of her active life, of her prophetic life, everything that she's always thought now has come under question. She's in a situation of busha, boshesh. She's in a situation of transition now. She's no longer so clear about what she thinks is the case. And suddenly here she is in an interim place, in a limbo place, having to try to work out what she thinks now. She's engrossed in that intermediary place. She's in the midst of things now without being so sure that things are quite as simple as she had thought they were. There had been a kind of ecstatic simplicity, about her original experience of prophecy. And now suddenly she's faced with the unalterable reality of Moses' separate existence, that he is different from her. And that, in a way, ruptures her basic assumptions about the world. When she is put outside the camp for 7 days, as I imagine it then, it's not just waiting for the leprosy to clear up. In fact, probably the leprosy had cleared up before she's put outside the camp. She is waiting for that process of, call it shame, that process of boshesh, of the time gap, which comes to complicate what at first seems to be instantaneous and simple, and I know that everything can go together with everything, and there's no discrepancies, and there's no problems, and suddenly there she is in the process of having to deal with something that she doesn't really know what to think, how to think about it. It's a process, I would say, as in the Garden of Eden, it's the process of hit-or-rut. It's the process which is purely human, not like Adam and Eve in the garden. They didn't know from such processes. Whenever they wanted, they were there. They were there in this world, in the next world. They were there in the total intimacy of relationship. And there is no contradiction between relationships and so forth. Suddenly, Miriam finds herself in the very human situation. Right? This is not the Eden situation. It's the very human situation of living in different states, that there are different states of being that one lives in, and that one lives, perhaps the closest person to one in life, because of the history here, and that is her brother, Moses. She is both very close to him and very like him and very different from him. And that means a need for a certain hit or a root, a certain arousal to a way of thinking and a way of feeling that she doesn't yet know. The most moving part of the story, I think, is when we read how the people wait for her. That is, she is outside the camp, and the people don't move until she's ready to join them. That is, until she's come, in some sense, to terms with the newly complicated human life that she begins to sense in herself. The aim of this exercise is not that she should renege, or that she should in some way deny the authenticity of her prophetic experience. The aim of it is that somehow this profoundly passionate woman, right? It's a woman, this is a woman who one can identify with on many levels, should come to recognize in a way the tragic fact of distances and differences. At the same time as she knows that there are moments of ecstasy in which these differences and distances seem to be elided. Unlike Moses, she doesn't live an even life. She lives a life in which she is precipitated into one moment and then into the next moment. And her lifelong goal is to find a way of living these states in the midst of things, right in the midst of the camp. She's put outside the camp, and she spends the time there trying to make real to herself this newly complicated way of thinking of the different states of a human being. Only after that is she gathered into the camp, and that expression that's used over and over again about unusual people, whether they are on the one hand lepers, or whether they are on the other hand inspired people who are different from others. There is a process outside the camp which then allows them to be gathered in, as it were, to come home within the camp. And the people waits for her as she waited for Moses in that original scene. And the Midrash makes the analogy. As she waited then, so she is waited for now. It's as if the camp of normalcy, of the people living their normal lives, can't continue without her. But she has an essential place within the camp, and so they wait respectfully, and respectfully of the totality of her experience, of what it is that she now has to think through, that she has to in some way find a way, engrossed in this complexity, She has to find a way of making sense of that complex reality. In the end, she's brought back into the camp, and she is there to enrich the camp for the rest of their journeys. And I'll finish with the Me'a Shiloach. The Me'a Shiloach says very simply, and I don't think I put it on your page, he says something like this. The wilderness experience is an experience in which all the greatest people got to know the Midbar in themselves. Moses, Miriam, and some of the villain heroes, someone like Korah, he was a great man. There are great people in this story. And all of them had to discover the Midbar within themselves. The greater they are, in a sense, the more difficult that discovery is. To find that which is, what can I say, that which has not been the unthought known, Christopher Bolas calls it, that which is on some level known, but never really thought through, never really engaged with. And that is the role, I would say, of Miriam. The Me'a Shiloach quotes from Kohelet, where he says, what does he say? Ein tzaddik ba'aretz asher ya'aseh tov ve'lo yichta. There is no righteous person on earth who lives in the world who will do good and will not sin. That's the quotation. On the face of it, it means there is no person who's perfect. Yes, there's no person who only does good and never sins. But Rabbi Yosef Albo has a penetrating comment on this, which in a way I think says something about Miriam, particularly. He reads it, there is no righteous person on earth who in doing good does not sin. That is that good and evil are mixed up. In the real world, good and evil are mixed up with each other. That precisely, that the woman who is inspired, the woman who knows what it is to have God speak in her and through her, is also the woman who needs to acknowledge what I'm calling the distances and differences. That there are gaps and there are spaces. And somehow to deal with these paradoxes of inside and outside, of like and unlike. And that is the fate of all righteous people, that in the midst of doing good, that is, in the midst of doing what they're made to do, there's no such thing as not also sinning. That is, also somehow getting it a little wrong, being skewed in some way. And that, I would say, particularly of Miriam, something about Miriam that gives one the sense of a kind of almost indescribable greatness, that there is something, she is the woman prophet. And there she is by the side of the male prophet. The tensions that arise, the tensions that have to do with empathy and envy that arise in that situation, that's something that Miriam, this great woman, has to come to recognize. She recognizes it alone and outside the camp. And when she has gone through this process of what's called arousal, that is, of bringing into life parts of her that perhaps she was not aware of before, then she can come and rejoin the people in the camp, and then she can live as a vital resource for her people to the end of the journey. Thank you.
Dr. Zornberg, I'm sure I speak for everyone here, and thank you for your enlightenment and your profundity in walking us through this text and making it so accessible to us. You can all take off your seatbelts now. I just want to remind you that Dr. Zornberg's books are available for purchase in the lobby, and she will be there to sign the books and answer any questions. And I also want to remind everyone that we have two lectures upcoming One on May 27th with Ruth Calderon, who is a member of the Knesset. This is part of our Skirball JPS series, and she will be talking about her new book, A Bridge for One Night, Talmudic Tales. And on June 10th, Rabbi Mark Schneier and Imam Shamsi Ali will share in a candid conversation about the issues that divide and unite Jews and Muslims in a program entitled Sons of Abraham. Both of these programs are free and open without reservation, so please join us and have a good evening. Thank you.